Hello explorers and welcome to another video. Today I'm going to talk a little bit about Swagger middlewares, about cross-origin request sharing, of course, and Firebase authentication. And all this is actually in the umbrella of Swagger middlewares. Firebase authentication, I don't want to talk too much about it because I have a video that describes exactly how you add Firebase authentication to your own video. So you can follow the link up in the corner over there and watch everything about that. And also, if you want to know a little bit more about why I'm not going to do a live coding session today. I have actually hurt my arm. I will have a video about that too. So you can, if you care about me, you can watch that video and get a little bit more information about that. So let's go into this then. This example I have done here, I added the Firebase app and Firebase auth to the client app. And then I just copied something from the old example over. So I have this Firebase app, Firebase auth, and authentication by Google. I also added this Iron IX call to my notes endpoint, and I'm posting to that. And I also kept this login with Google function, which sends this Firebase token to the backend server. Everything that I've talked about here is covered in the other video. So let's go into our Swagger definition, how we set up Firebase auth or OAuth authentication. So in this case, I first set up a security definition. I gave it a name and I also gave it a type, OAuth. And the flow is access code. These two I never use. I'm not really sure if I need to specify authentication URL and token URL. And you also need to specify scopes, but I never use those either. And you also have to have a block of security, auth security. So if you change this type to different types, you have implicit, or the flow. The flow is actually, you could have implicit and password and so on. And the type could be a few different values as well. Then the different parameters that you need to add to your definition changes. So that's a good way to actually encapsulate what things you need to add. But I wanted to have most of these informations in here because I might want to extend my functionality another time so it actually covers some of these things, but for now I'm not using them. So this is what I have added to my Swagger definition. So let's go into the index.js, my server, and here I added the Firebase admin to this server. I also added the body parser, so it will parse the body of the message. And also a service account file, and that's a file that you download from your Firebase account, so you can actually talk to your Firebase backend. And then I set up my admin app here, just give it some credentials and a database URL. And when we come down here to middlewares, then we can start by talking about cores, this cross-origin resource sharing. And the thing about cores is that you want to actually call your API from your website. But nothing says that you need to talk from your website to the same URL. You can talk to any URL, but it's not safe to go out on the internet and just pull another server, because that server might not want you to talk to it. So there, this is where cores come in. So if you haven't specified cores and send a lot of information to some endpoint backend, it might say just, nope, I don't want to talk to you. You're not from the same origin that I am from. So if you have a server on, let's say, example.com and talk to another server on example.com, that is totally fine and will be just done for you. But if you want to talk to a different origin than your origin, then you need to specify what that origin is. So in my case, I change the port numbers, so I have localhost 8181 that is talking to this server. So I say that it's okay for you to talk to me. And I also specify that it's okay for you to get request, put request, post request, patch request, or delete request to me, but nothing else. So that's what I require of you to give me to this server. And I also say that it's okay that you send credentials to me, because I could also say that you are not allowed to send cookies with credentials over to me, because I'm not allowing that. So if you don't specify these things, the client server that I implemented, or the client application that I implemented, will not work, because it will send credentials, it will be on a different port, and so on. And then I added the body parser, and added that the body parser should also be URL encoded, so you get all your values back as an object, a JavaScript object, instead of just some raw data. So it will create a body object on your request, so you can fetch your data from that. Then we come to this Swagger metadata, and in Swagger metadata you can actually specify a lot of different things that you want to change in your Swagger definition. So you can give some extra information where your resources are and what your API URL is, and so on. So this is done in the Swagger metadata block, or middleware. The next is this middleware I've looked more into now. It's the Swagger security middleware. And here I implemented my OAuth security method. As you see here, I have this naming convention, OAuth security. And if we look in the YAML file, I actually have that definition over here. And I also said that my security is handled by this function. And this enables that this function will actually be called. This function takes a request, some definition, some scopes, and a callback. And the definition and scope, I don't look at those at the moment. But in here I will create an auth on my admin and verify the cookie that I give the server from the client. And when the cookie is decoded, I will check that it is one specific cookie, which is my own login. And if it is, it will return the callback and the processing will continue in the server. If not, I will just give a 401 wrong authentication, and if it catches an error, I will give the same response back. So this is a very simple way to implement OAuth security with Firebase on your site. Of course, if you want to do this a little bit more specific, you can actually use the scopes and also send more information to your callback, which API endpoints is allowed to be called, and so on. So you can really mix this up a lot more, but this is the simplest case where you just say that one user has access to your backend API, and if any other credential comes through, it will not be allowed. So I just wanted to show you how you can set up a very basic security middleware in your server. Next up, we have a very interesting middleware. It's the Swagger validator. And this will validate that your request is correct, which you usually want to do, but it can also validate that the response is true. And in my case, when I turned response validation on, it failed. Because in my Swagger, I had on, let's say, the get, I only defined that a 200 will return, it will return a 200 with all the notes as a description. but I hadn't said what kind of data was returned. So it will actually break there and say that it's required or it was it really thought that it should get a void object back. It shouldn't get any data back, but it actually got an array. So that's something it will check and give you an error on if you're not fulfilling the specification to the fullest. So in my case, I had to add the schema, and I had to say that the type back should be an array, and the items in the array should be of the type note. And when I did that, everything worked as intended. I got the array of all my notes, and the validation went through. And next up, we have the router. Here I specify the Swagger UI JSON file. And in this case, I think that's something that is generated for your Swagger UI, because I use a YAML file. And next up, we have the controllers. And this is a very interesting block for you. You can actually either give it a simple string, and that will tell it that this string says where all the controllers are actually available. So in my case, all my controllers is in the directory controllers. But you can also give it an array, and that will tell you which controllers is actually available. And you can also give it an object where you have key value pairs saying that this controller is in this directory and so on. So it's very configurable. And the last thing here is, if you want to just develop a client against this and you want just to have some generated data, so you don't want to implement the full server when you are creating something, you can actually turn this to development mode, and that will stub out all of the APIs, so it will not go down to the database. In my case, it will just give some random data back. It can also be used if you want to test your API. You can also put it into development mode and set this use stubs to true, and that will return some stub data. And the last middleware in the set of middlewares from Swagger is the Swagger UI middleware. And here you can actually define a few different things, but the most interesting, I thought, was the API docs. And if you specify this and go to docs, you will see the current documentation. So you just the JSON file that is generated for your server. So you can go through and see what server has actually loaded. And the Swagger UI will give you a front end with all your different endpoints, and also give you buttons so you can try the different endpoints and give it data and so on, and try your service and so on out. So yeah, these are the middlewares that are defined in Swagger. And I also talked a little bit about cores and why you need to specify these data in order to get the communication between your client and your server done. And I also went through a little bit about how Firebase could be implemented in a Swagger context. If you want to implement it in a better way, I have a video for that, as I said earlier. So watch that video. And this is what I wanted to go through today. I hope you learned something today. I hope you found this video interesting. And please give me a comment if you have any questions about this. And I really hope to see you in the next one.